morning, New Life. We're so glad you're here to worship with us. Why don't you stand up, get on your feet.
There is a river where goodness flows. There is a fountain that drowns sorrow. There is an ocean deeper than fear. The tide is rising, rising. And there is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart of God. The flood of heaven crashing over.
If I got is for us, then who could ever
Darkest places, God, you reach down, you rescue us in our worst conditions, God, in our most shameful places, Father, in our darkest moments, God, we're just so thankful for Jesus, who breaks free from heaven to save us, God, and it is a privilege and an honor to worship you this morning. It's in your Son's name we pray, amen.
Good morning and welcome to New Life. I'm Pat. You may have a seat. I'm Pat and I'm one of the ministers here at New Life and I'm glad you're here. Did you see who was in the lobby? Who was in the lobby? Elvis, that's right. So if it's not obvious, which it's probably not, we are talking about marriage this morning. So we thought, hey, why not bring out Elvis? So get your picture taken with him on the way out if you didn't on the way in. Anyway, I'm so glad you're all here. I hope you got one of these also when you came in. There's lots of great information in here about our upcoming family service, the backpack drive, stuff like that. I'll talk about a couple other things later. But my favorite piece is the narrow piece of paper. This is a great opportunity for you to give us your prayer request. We have a great prayer team, and they love praying specifically for you and for specifically what's going on in your life. We actually had a few people prayed for in person during the second service. So we would love to be able to do that for you. And if you're new and you fill this out and give us your contact information, we will pop a small gift in the mail for you and give you information about what's going on at New Life so that you can get as involved as you'd like to be. No more than you'd like to be, but as much as you'd like to be. So Brett will be out in just a minute. But before he does, let's take just a few seconds to stand up, show a little New Life hospitality, say hi to someone next to you. We'll be right back.
Thank you. Well, you're nice to remember the taste of my love. Will your eyes just smile from your cheeks? And darling, I will be loving you till you're 70. And maybe my heart can still fall as hard at 23. And I'm thinking about how people fall in love in mysterious ways. And maybe just a touch of a hand. Me, I fall in love with you every single day. And I just wanna tell you I am. So honey, now take me to your loving arms. Kiss me under the light of a thousand stars. Please shoot it on my beating heart. I'm thinking out loud, and maybe we found love right where we are. Where my hands are gone. Crowds don't remember my name. Well, my hands don't play the strings the same way. Ooh, I know you still love me the same. Cause honey, your song can never grow old. It's evergreen. And maybe your smile
Well, good morning. I think if he cut an album of love songs, he could make millions of dollars, don't you? And then work for free. He could too. Good to have you here with us this morning. My grandparents married when they were teenagers. And I'm sure that there were days and months and maybe even years where they wondered if they made a serious mistake and married the wrong person. But they married for better or for worse, and as a result, they celebrated 72 anniversaries together. And I'm really blessed that they did. In fact, one of my favorite memories of my grandfather's in the last week of his life, he was being interviewed by somebody from the VA, and they asked him if he ever had been married, and he said yes, and I chimed in. He and my grandmother were married for 72 years, and before anybody else could take a breath, my grandfather chimed in with the exact number of months and weeks and days. I thought he was going to give the minute and seconds, and if we'd give him time. But it's like the longer they were married, the more they cherished each other and the blessing that God gave them. But it's no exaggeration to say that modern view of marriage is not what it used to be. In fact, there was a census taken not long ago, and in it they asked young people, what is extremely important to you? 62% said a good education, extremely important, good for them. 52% said a good career, extremely important, good for them. Guess how many said marriage is extremely important? 12%. Just 12%. There is no institution in the world more important for society than the marriage, and yet we're raising a generation that only 12% really thinks it's that important. So in that view, I think it's important for us, because of the abuse that marriage takes, because of the views of marriage that tend to be propagated on the news and in entertainment today, it's important for us to remember that marriage indeed is sacred. It's God's idea. He made it, and if we're wise, He guides it. Maybe you've heard it said that the best way that a husband, a dad, can love his children is by loving their mother. Well, I think it's also true that the best way Christian couples can love the world is by loving each other and modeling Christian marriage in a dark world. Jesus said, "You're the light of the world," and I'm convinced that if the world could just see marriage as God intends, marriage as God designs, it would not only have greater impact in any election, it would have such an attractive appeal and power, you wouldn't be able to keep people away from the church. So today and next week, I hope you'll listen closely as we talk about Christian marriage. And no matter how long you've been married, we can all use a reminder of the basics of marriage. We're going to talk about that today from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 21 through 23. I want to begin by reading verse 21 because it gives us a wonderful, succinct, two-point outline for us to follow. First, talking to husbands, it says that a husband should love his wife as himself and let the wife see that she respects her husband. First, husbands. The passage addresses, love your wives. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, I pray that you will do a strong work today for your glory, that you would bring wisdom where there's confusion, that you would bring strength in marriages that are already strong, that you would bring healing to marriages that are hurting and broken. Through Christ, I pray these things. Lord, do your work is our prayer through Christ. Amen. Husbands, love your wives. The first thing I want you to notice about that, it's a command. It's not an emotion. The Bible never says the key to a happy marriage is that you find the right person. If you just find Miss Right, then you'll be happy the rest of your life. But that's kind of what gets communicated to us through the years. You turn on Gone with the Wind and Scarlett O'Hara sees Rhett Butler across the room, and it is love at first sight, and there are sparks that begin to fly, and the next thing you know, it's civil war, right? I mean, it's just fighting one after another. Or you listen to music, that you know, this, you're going to meet each other, and immediately you're going to change your life. There's a country song, actually, that says, I changed her oil, she changed my life. You know, it's kind of like that. It was kind of like we meet each other and it's rapturous immediately. That's romantic love. It's a wonderful thing. I hope there's sparks For a couple at the beginning, certainly to bring them together, there needs to be, but that's essentially self-centered. There's a deeper level of love that we experience when we start living in the real world, when reality sets in. I often like to tell couples in a wedding, the tendency of relationships is that when you are dating, you tend to emphasize, focus on the positives and diminish the negatives. But after you get married, the tendency is all of a sudden those positives that you found so attractive don't seem so important anymore. But those negatives that you ignored become real irritating. You start to see them in technicolor, but it gets worse than that. What actually happens is those positives that you once thought were so wonderful, all of a sudden you start seeing the dark side. So before you're married, you're attracted to him because he's a great athlete. You love to go watch him play sports. After you're married, I can't get him off the ball field. Before you're married, I love how she dresses. She takes care of herself. After your marriage, her clothing budget is killing us. Before you're married, he's fun-loving. Oh, he's just so fun to be around. After you're married, he can't hold a job. Before you're married, she's such a wonderful conversationalist. After you're married, enough said, it's midnight, she's still talking. In the reality stage, that's when you really love. The word for love used here in Ephesians chapter 5 is the word agape. It's not eros love, emotional love, it's unselfish love. It is the love that Jesus uses in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave. Jesus didn't feel loving when he left heaven for earth. He did the loving thing. That's why he abandoned heaven for earth. And so husbands, love your wives as Christ loves us. Reminds me of the story of the true story. The husband that went to the preacher said, my wife and I don't love each other anymore. We're going to get a divorce. Preacher said, I'm sorry to hear that. But you're going to have to love her. You're a Christian. That's what the Bible commands. Husbands, love your wives. Preacher, he said, honestly, you don't understand. I just don't feel anything anymore. The feelings are all gone. There's no attraction to each other. I mean, there's nothing. Preacher said, oh, okay, that's different. That takes a little deeper level of love. That's kind of like with your neighbor. You don't necessarily feel in love with them, but you that's why Jesus said, you got to love your neighbor as yourself. Preacher said, the husband said, it's worse than that. You don't understand. I can't stand being around her. I mean, I can't stand to look at her. What she says irritates me. How she treats the kids irritates me. How she talks to me irritates me. She drives me crazy. I really just kind of despise her. Preacher said, oh, and I bet she's a Cowboys fan too. No, he didn't say that really, but Preacher said, oh, that's kind of how you feel like she's an enemy. Yeah, well, you know what Jesus said. Gotta love your enemies, so you gotta love her. How in the world can I do that? The man said. The preacher said, well, first, you need to get over this Hollywood idea that love is a feeling that controls you. That's immature. Jesus' love is doing the right thing no matter how you feel. So here's what you need to do. Go home, make a list. What are all the things that you would do with your wife if you felt in love with her? Go make a list and do those things this week, no matter how you feel. The husband said, I can't do that. I'd be a hypocrite. The priest said, no, you don't understand hypocrisy. Hypocrisy isn't acting contrary to the way you feel. Hypocrisy is acting contrary to what you believe. This is called obedience. Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. You will obey me. We won't always keep his commandments because we feel like it. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. That means we need to sacrifice for our wives. Jesus said, greater love is no one than this, than he would lay down his life for a friend. I remember studying this Ephesians passage one time in a small group that we had years ago. Bob Brow was in it, Bob and Joy. And I remember Bob coming to this point and saying, you know what this means to me? Some of you remember Bob, he's a great guy. He says, you know what this says, husbands? That tells me that if I'm really not loving my wife until it feels like it's killing me to love her. I remember thinking, man, that's right. I wish he hadn't said that. I've been convicted about that ever since. That's true. That's what it means to love your wife. That means, husbands, you are unselfish with your money. One of the things my mom always said about my dad, and that he was unselfish with money. My dad loved to play sports. Played in 3 softball teams when he was 65 years old. Everybody loved to have him on their team. My dad never spent money on himself, though. My mom would tell you, never spent money on himself to play sports. He used basically a rag. I don't know how he caught a thing with that glove. Husbands, you know what it means? It means you love to be stingy. You prefer to be stingy with yourself so you can be generous with your wife. Hey, she wants to spend money because she needs to want something. You would rather you go without so she can and even indulge if she needs to. It means we give up comforts for them. You'd rather stay at home because you're tired, you want to read or rest. And she says, honey, I want to go shopping. Do you want to go shopping with me? And what do you say? A lie. Yes, I want to go shopping with you. You do. That means you give up time. You have plans. You want to go golfing with the boys or something. And you hear your wife say, man, that garden in the front yard is a mess. And you know what that means. So you sacrifice time. And I say this, and I just feel like a hypocrite standing in front of you, to be honest with you. I kind of feel like the preacher who was on his way home with his wife in the car one day and said to her, you know, dear, I think that second point I made on marriage today would have been a lot more effective if you hadn't said, ha, in the middle of it. Oh, we try. We fail and we try better. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. That also means that you overlook her faults. It says there in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, Christ loved the church, gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, purify her, having cleansed her by the washing with water by the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Husbands, how do you perfect your wife? How do you present your wife as holy? You know what the world says? The world says, correct her. Point out to her. You know, what do you do? And you do it just because you want to help, right? Do you remember the story of President Garfield? President Garfield was shot in a train depot downtown by somebody that he refused to give a job. And so what happened? Experts today tell us if they just would have left the wound alone, he would have been fine. There were a lot of vets from the Civil War who had worse wounds than he did, who lived their entire lives with bullets inside them. Leave it alone, it's okay. But he's the president of the United States, so they want to help. And so his doctor, Dr. Willard Bliss, pokes and prods and pokes and prods because he wants to get that thing out. And afterward, it was really clear he did not die from the bullet. He died from the infection introduced by all the poking and prodding. Husbands, you poke and you prod because in your mind you rationalize you just want to help. You're just trying to help her improve. But you know what the Bible says, how we change people in the New Testament? It is by poking and prodding that you are saved. It's by grace you're saved. In fact, the book of Titus says in Titus chapter 2 that yes, grace not only redeems us, it reforms us. It is grace that teaches us to say no to ungodliness. It is by grace that we learn to obey. Husbands, love your wives. Quit the poking and prodding and just love her by grace. And all the wives said, you don't really believe the wives? Okay, well, husbands just keep poking and prodding. They don't, apparently don't. Yeah, Billy Graham's wife, Ruth Graham, one time said, it's God's responsibility to change Billy Graham. It's my responsibility to love Billy Graham. Wives, or husbands, love your wives. Enough of the poking and prodding, even though you feel like you're just trying to help. Another thing we can do is we need to nurture our wives. The Bible says in Ephesians 5:28, in the same way husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Florida judge handed down an unusual sentence in a domestic dispute. During a courthouse hearing, Judge Hurley turned to the husband and said, Mr. Bray, I have an assignment for you. First, figure out marriage counseling. Second, and then he spoke to the whole group and he said, Mr. Bray is going to stop somewhere today and get some flowers for his wife. And he's going to get a card. He's going to get some flowers and a card, and then he's going to go home and pick up his wife, get dressed, and take her to Red Lobster. After Red Lobster, he's going to take her bowling. One of the attorneys spoke up and said, "Your Honor, does that mean he also has to let her win?" The judge says, "No, he doesn't have to let her win, but I'm serious about this. If he fails to follow through, he will be back in court." The judge went on to explain that he realized that there was a minor incident, but he didn't want to let Mr. Bray off the hook. So after checking with his wife, Mrs. Bray, she did not feel comfortable yet bringing him back into the home. But, she said, "I love my husband and I want to work things out." So the judge then turned to Mr. Bray again and he said, "Mr. Bray, flowers, card, Red Lobster, bowling. You've got your work cut out for you. Do you understand?" "Yes, sir," Mr. Bray replied. "I understand." Husbands, love your wife. Nourish and cherish her. You have your work cut out for you this week, today. Do you understand? Nourish her. What would that look like for you this week to be more loving and nourishing this week than you were last week? Flowers, card, Red Lobster, bowling? Probably not for most of you. How about working in the yard? How about listening non-defensively? How about more non-sexual touch? How about asking her from time to time, "How can I help you?" How about praying for her every day? "God bless my wife. God, help me to be a better husband. God, grow our marriage." Let the husband love his wife. And let the wife see that she respects her husband. Now, notice a couple of things about that. First of all, notice that respect is not an emotion either. It's a command. Just like love is a command, not a feeling, so it doesn't say respect your husband if you feel like it. Respect him if he graduated from college, has an impressive position, impressive salary, has a 5% body fat rate, and doesn't use much Rogaine very often. No, respect is an attitude that you have for your marriage that is more a reflection of your character than his. Just like we teach our kids, you respect your teacher because she's the teacher. You respect the police officer because she's the police officer. You respect your husband because he's your husband. Does that mean that you passively accept everything that he does? No. Or abuse? Certainly not. But it means that we develop a respectful attitude. We do our best. Notice also that the command here is different from the command to husbands. Husbands are command to love. Wives are command to respect. But the first thing that shows us that the Bible is simply admitting that men and women are different. There are some people today that because of an unbiblical worldview and they want, you know, kind of the sort of weird look of things, there's like, men and women aren't different at all. It's like, balderdash. Of course they're different. There's lots of ways that they're different. Men are from Mars, women are from Venus. In her book, Married Beyond Recognition, Sylvia Harney points out there are a number of differences between men and women. For instance, how they handle telephone conversations. Many women may take 5 minutes and cover 6 different topics before making a lunch appointment. Men call and take care of it in 15 seconds. We're different in the way we handle other things. The use of the remote control. The way that we determine when clothes are dirty. Women by sight, men, who knows? The length of time it takes for us to get ready for bed. And when was the last time you heard one guy say to another guy, "I'm going to the bathroom, do you want to go with me?" And you never see a woman clean her ears with a car key. So we're not surprised when God says, husbands, love your wives, respect your husbands. You know, love's the most important thing. Why does it say respect? You know, I think part of it is, wives, if you want to say, "I love you" to your husband, the best way to say that to your husband is, "I respect you." Show him respect. That makes him feel loved. So respect his role and responsibility. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22, I know is the favorite for many of you. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. This is about a house thing, by the way, a family thing. For the husband is the head of his wife, even as Christ is the head of his church, his body, and he gave himself and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Now, I know as soon as I read that, there are a lot of heebie-jeebies going on out there. A lot of people really uncomfortable with that, but you don't have to be. I am convinced that if you really understood what this said, you'd give the thumbs up. You'd say, that makes perfect sense. Now, let me say this just to be very direct. The degree to which this gives you trouble is the degree to which you don't understand the Bible and that you are more influenced by popular culture than you are by the Bible and Jesus Christ. Okay? What does this mean when it says, and when it talks like this, wives, submit to your husbands, respect your husbands. Work with me on this. Imagine we walk into the NRO tomorrow. It's my first day at work at the NRO. And so I ask somebody, who's in charge of the NRO? Who's the head here? Wouldn't it be ridiculous if somebody says to me, what do you mean, Brett, who's the head here? We are an egalitarian culture. We're all created equal. There's nobody in charge here because we're all equal. You'd say, that's ridiculous. That's crazy. You can't run an organization like that. Somebody would say, well, Betty Sapp is in charge here. She's the director of the NRO. But what if I would say, well, is she the smartest person here, the most experienced person? Is she the best leader? Is she doing the most important work here? Well, you say, in fact, I'm sure if you asked her, she would say there are better leaders, there are smarter people, there are more experienced people, there are probably people who do more important stuff than what she does. Now, what would you think if I stepped in and said, now, how can I work in a place where the person who's the head is not the smartest, most experienced, best leader? You say, Brett, you have a problem with authority and you don't understand how organizations work. One of the first rules of any organizations for it to work is you have to be able to point the finger of responsibility at somebody. Somebody has to take responsibility. Somebody has to be able to say that the buck stops there. Now imagine. Let me ask the question. Some of you work for the FBI or the CIA or military, or maybe you've started your own business. Imagine tomorrow we say, no more authority structures. Everybody's created equal, so how dare you have a director of the CIA or a director of the FBI or a president of your company? You say, again, Brett, that's crazy. You can't run an organization like that. Well, the FBI be if there's nobody in charge, if there's no line of authority? It would be crazy. It would be confusing. It would be chaos. Nothing would get done. It would be a lot like Congress, right? Just kind of chaotic, kind of strange. You wouldn't do that with the FBI. There's no more important organization to society than the home. You would say it is a cosmic dereliction of duty to have an FBI with no authority structure, where you point the finger of responsibility at nobody. That's ridiculous. It can't be done. Why would you imagine that God would create the most important organization in society that will transcend times and cultures long before there was an FBI? I mean, the world existed pretty well long before there was a United States CIA. But it's never existed without a family. What would you think about God creating the most important organization in the world and then saying nobody's responsible because we're all equal here? You would accuse him of a dereliction of duty because it would be crazy. Second problem that people have with this is because they don't understand what it means to be the head of something in Jesus' definition. Candidly, if the world's definition of leadership were what it means here, I would agree with feminists and say that it turns my stomach. Jesus' disciples had a problem with what leadership meant. They were confused by it as well, and so they were arguing about who's going to have the power positions when Jesus comes into his kingdom. Jesus pulls them all together in Matthew chapter 20 and says to them, "You know, rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them. Their great ones exercise authority over them." By the way, that is how people who are not Christians view authority even to this day, that headship means power, position, right? Again, the very people who criticize this would believe in authority the way the Gentiles believed it and practiced it. Jesus says, "But not so among you. Instead, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first among you must be your slave. Even as the Son of Man did not come to be served," Jesus said, "I've given you the example, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Leading doesn't mean power, position, ruling, or authority, exercising authority. It means serving. In other words, this is, men, what it means for you to be the head of your home. It means you are the first to serve. The finger of responsibility doesn't point at your wife. It doesn't point at your kids. It points first at you. Do you know what it means to be a leader if you're a Christian? What did Jesus say? You want to be a leader? Be a doulos. Be a slave. You know what husbands are to be? You are the slaves of the home, husbands. That's what it means for you to lead. You are the first to say, what is best for everybody else? I will sacrifice myself. I will empty myself so that others can benefit. That's what it means to be a husband, to lead, to be the head of the home. That's why one has paraphrased Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 this way. Wives, understand and support your husbands in a way that shows your support for Christ. Husbands, provide leadership to his wife the way Christ does to his church. Sacrificing himself. Not by domineering, but by cherishing. You know what I find funny? This is typical. The world will criticize the Bible and then be shocked when the fruit of their criticism is ugly. Anybody, I like to say to people who have a problem with the Bible on this, anybody here think the big problem in the world today is that men don't take enough responsibility? You know the big problem in the home, wives? Isn't the big problem that men don't serve enough? That men just serve too much. No. What's the problem in the home today? We talk about deadbeat dads. We talk about men needing to step up and be men and take responsibility. So here's what the world does. The world says the Bible's wrong. Arrogantly, the Bible is off on this whole thing about men being the head and servant and leading like Christ. And then they're shocked when men actually don't lead like Christ. Then they're disappointed when the world's a mess and families are a mess because families follow what the world believes. What does it mean practically to submit? Notice it does not mean you are a doormat or a second-class citizen. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21 is the context for all of it. It says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. It's a mutual submission thing. You know how it works in a good organization, or at least at New Life. I'm responsible for the preaching around here, okay? I'm responsible to make sure it gets done. I'm responsible for it to be of a certain level of quality. And if it doesn't happen right, it's my fault, okay? The finger points at me. Now, does that mean that I come up with all the best ideas for preaching? No. In fact, that's not the truth. In fact, you know what the most popular sermon series we do every year is? New Life at the Movies, where we take movies and try to teach biblical application Bible lessons out of those movies. Is that my idea? No, it wasn't. It was some staff idea years ago, and I hate it, to be honest with you. Okay, because it's one thing just to tell the Bible story and apply the Bible story. In that movie series, I have to like watch movies that I never watch, and then I have to tell the Bible story out of that movie, and I have to do it all within 35 minutes. You know, it's kind of like, okay, give me 3 hours, maybe I'll be able to figure out. It's just like, I hate doing it, and yet we do it every, and so we did it the first year, and unfortunately, people responded well. You know, so like, people responded, so okay, let's do it I don't like it. And personally, it's like not to my advantage, but people respond so well. See what happens? People submit an idea. I don't go, this is what I want. This is what's best for me. We say, okay, what's Lord, what do you want? What's best for the family? That's what godly, I hate to put myself like, okay, I got this one right, okay, but that's what it's supposed to look like in the home. I remember when Laura and I were married, early in our marriage, probably within the first, definitely within the first 2 years, we were driving into the parking lot talking about children. How many children do you want to have? If you are not yet married, this is my most practical suggestion for you this morning. Have that conversation before you get married. Good idea. She asked me, how many kids do you want to have? I said, well, I don't know. I was thinking like one, two. What about you? Laura said, well, my dad's family, oh my word, as soon as she said that, I mean, her dad's family had like 85 children in it. My dad came from a large family. I like large families. I was thinking five or six. And so we talked it through. She submitted her idea, and I submitted right back, mutually submission, and we have four children today. And 27 years later, I'm really glad. So that's what it looks like. It's like, it's not domineering. 27 years, Lauren, I've never had the conversation about who's in charge here. It's each of you trying to sacrifice for each other, sacrifice for what's the best of the family and the marriage. Kind of give you some practical ideas for respect. By the way, I love Ron Deal has a great line. He says, respect is like chocolate to a man's soul. Wives, how can you respect your husband? Avoid rolling your eyes at him when he's speaking to you. You know those times it's tempting. Maintain a united front with him, especially in front of the kids. Find something he likes to do and do it with him. I'm so glad my wife likes to watch baseball with me and football with me too. For some of you wives, that'd be like death to you, I know. Accept when he tries to be generous. Don't criticize. Say thank you for being so thoughtful. Don't say, what did you do wrong this time? Or, we can't afford that. Unless there's a safety issue, don't constantly correct them. That's not how you diaper a baby. That's not how you feed the kids. That's not how I would do the dishes. Initiate intimacy. Don't humiliate him all the time. And let him know you admire him. Praise him. There are a lot of nice people that say a lot of nice things about my sermons every week. And I appreciate that. And keep them coming, you know. But when my wife does not throw around compliments like candy. And when she says, Brett, that was a good sermon today. Laura's out of town today. She sent me a text after first service. She said, Brett, that was a good sermon today. I tell you, that means more to me than 1,000 other people saying, good job. You know why? Because she's my wife. And I love her. And her opinion means more to me than anybody else's. Wives, praise your husband. Find something you admire him for. And if he has a heart at all, that'll be like precious gold to him. Now, one more thing. I know some of you wives say, Brian, I would be more submissive. It just made a little more sense. I just understood. Why wives, is this the direction? Well, let me ask the question this way. Any of you wives want to change your husbands? Don't raise your hand. What have you found that's effective? Most of you, if you're smart, probably say, you know what, I discovered I can't change my husband. You know, I've tried words, I've tried the frying pan, nothing seems to change him. What if I were to say to you, there is one, if there's a chance to change your husband, you're right, you can't change him, you can't be his Holy Spirit. There's one possible thing you can do to change him. Would you be interested? Just practical help? In 1 Peter chapter 3, Peter is addressing wives who are married to unbelieving husbands. Now, is there a more difficult change than leading somebody to Christ? Is there a more important change? Peter gives the direction to wives about how to change their husbands. And Peter writes, "Wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word." By the way, if I can say in passing, this is what you get because you're in third service and not the first two. Both places we've read today talk about being subject to your own husbands. This is about authority. This is about how the home works. This is not about society in general. You know, women, we ought to be able to respect and admire and lead in any way, okay? It's about the home. Be it, and so to your own husbands, it's about the family. Anyway, that even if some do not obey the word, if some of your husbands are not believers, that they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives. What conduct? When they see your respectful and pure conduct. Peter says, wives, you want the chance to change your husbands? Have a humble attitude, submissive attitude, be respectful. You know who teaches this? Psychologists. They just don't always make the connection. Years ago, they talked about the looking glass self. The way that we see ourselves is the way that we think the most significant person in our life sees us. That's why we've taught through the years. You have a young child who's very smart and very capable, but you have parents that are constantly saying, "You're not very good, you're not very capable, you're not very smart, you're not very capable." They will grow up to be adults who feel insecure, like there's always somebody who's smarter, there's always somebody who's more capable. Why? Because the looking glass self, the most significant people in their lives, have communicated to them, "You're not capable, you're not smart, other people are better." But you take that same child and put it into a home where there's affirmation, where people believe, "Hey, I know it didn't go so well, but just learn from that. You'll get them next time." And you'll raise a child that is stronger, more confident. Why? Because of the looking glass self, because of how that child believes the most significant people in their life, what they believe about them. Wives, there's nobody more significant to your husband than you. Nobody's opinion who has more influence on them than you. And when you respect your husband, over a period of time, there's a chance he might just become the man you respect him to be. That's the biblical principle. That's the chance. Gabrielle Reese, nobody would call a wilting flower. She's a 6'3" professional volleyball player and fitness expert. On the Today Show a couple of years ago, 2013, she shared the secret for a happy marriage. It came out of her book that she wrote called "My Foot is Too Big for the Glass Slipper." In that book, she said she and her husband were about divorced 4 years in marriage, but now their marriage at that point 17 years strong and solid. And what was the key? Submission. She wrote, "To be truly feminine means being soft and receptive and submissive." What did that look like for her? She wrote, "I think the idea of living with a married partner is each person saying, 'How can I make the best of your life? How can I make your life better?'" She said, "I think women have the ability to set the tone for the home, and that is ultimate strength. That shows real power. I believe that in creating that environment, by always thinking, 'How can I make the situation better for you?' that we set the tone and by strength set the marriage." According to the Today Show online survey, not scientific, 55% of the viewing audience agreed with Reese's statement, while 19% disagreed. The Bible says, "Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church." Husbands, what are you going to do to love your wife, to sacrifice for her more this week than last week? And wives, respect your husbands. Say, "I love you today," through a respectful spirit. And when you do, Your marriage won't just be better, but God will be honored. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you for Christ and for Christ's example of submission. Nobody was ever greater than Jesus. And yet, he didn't just submit to you. He surrendered for us out of strength that we might live. God, I pray for every husband in this place to rededicate himself to love like Christ, to be the first to empty, to act selflessly out of confidence in you and love for our wives, and for wives to trust you as well, and to live not for themselves and or rebellious spirit, but for you who gave your life for us. Through Christ, I pray these things. Amen. What a wonderful thing to be able to celebrate communion right now. If you're a husband, as I said in that prayer, your challenge this week is to love your family, love your wife as Christ loved the church. So as you take of communion, you hold on to cracker and cup, you look at what Christ did to love you on the cross, what he gave up out of love for you, and you hold on to that, and then realize he rose from the dead to give you the power to do that. Wives, what does it mean for you to respect, to not have a rebellious spirit, which is the opposite of a submissive spirit, but to have the spirit of Christ, who in power emptied himself that we might live. Trusting God. The only way Christ said that, he trusts the Father, is going to take care of him. Wives, the only way you can do this is you trust God is going to take care of you and will lift you up to the highest place. If you're not a follower of Jesus Christ, I don't know how you obey. I don't know how you walk through life and have marriage that's successful. Not only do you lack the real direction and understanding of who Jesus is, because you haven't accepted his crucifixion and resurrection, but you don't have the power of the Holy Spirit with you. So I call you today, give your life to Jesus Christ, find salvation in him, and then be baptized into him and walk with him in the power of his Holy Spirit, and he'll help you every step of the way. If you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, that's not a game. Give your life to him today. Start new today. Be baptized today. And he'll walk with you every step of the way, and you'll be, for eternity, you'll be so glad you did. Whatever next step, I pray that you'll do it right now in this quiet time in communion. And when we're done, I'll close with a prayer. Let's share right now in communion, please. Let's pray together, please. How have you heard God speaking to you in these last few moments? Respond to him right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us, that you'd speak to us. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us by walking this earth with us and dying for us on the cross so our sins could be forgiven, taking the penalty that we deserve to pay. And we thank you that he conquered death, and so we can know hope. No matter how hopeless situations feel, if you were able to bring Jesus back from the dead, there is no marriage that is so far gone that you cannot resurrect it. God, we thank you for your power and your hope. And we just pray whatever you want to do in our lives right now, you would do. We open ourselves up to you. Say, Lord, here we are. Make us yours. It's through Christ we pray these things. Amen. Whatever next step you have to take, I pray that you'll take it right now with God. If you need to give your life to Christ, you need somebody to pray with, or you have some, maybe you have know somebody who's married and needs prayer, and with people in the back who'd be glad, you say, hey, will you pray for my friends? And if you need to keep that anonymous, that's fine, but there are people in the back who are glad to help you every step of the way for decision for Christ, decision for prayer. If you're interested in knowing more about New Life, there are people back there at Take 5 as well. I'll be glad to, in 5 minutes, share with you the basics about New Life. If it goes over 5 minutes, they owe you season tickets to the Nationals. Actually, that's not true. We're going to take up our offering right now, and this is a continuation of our worship. Just as we want our singing to be a genuine expression of worship, I pray that our giving is. If you want to give online, that's a wonderful thing. There are a lot of different ways to give online. A lot of people do that electronically, but again, think about what you have given if you've already given. There are wonderful people who will commit 10 or 15% ahead of time. They will commit that, and it allows us to budget accordingly. But again, make that a spiritual thing, that you say, God, we give you our heart, not just our money, and we pray that you would do more through that than we can do ourselves. There are the first 12% of New Life offerings goes to help start new churches to reach people all around the world. God, make that money be effective for your kingdom, for your glory. And God, change my heart as I'm trusting you with my stuff that you've given me, right? So make this a spiritual time is my challenge for you. And if you're new here and aren't ready to give, that's between you and God. That's fine. We just ask everybody to think through, what is God saying to me? What would I give if I really want to worship God today and give that way? So let's go ahead and take up the offering. Our announcements today are brought to us by Pat Ferguson, our executive pastor. Would you bring Pat on with some appreciation this morning, please?
Good morning. Good to be here. One thing Brett didn't mention on the offering was that 12% of everything that you give goes towards church planting, and I think that's phenomenal that we not only tied the first 10%, but actually go above a little bit to 12%, and that's huge because it allows us to be part of church planting all across the nation. We have 3 churches starting in September, in part due to you and your generosity. We have... I'm see if I can get them all right. We have Michael Bartlett launching in Frederick. We have Tim Wolf in Owings Mills and Joel Pasmino in Columbia Heights. So we're really excited about them. That's great stuff. And I haven't even gotten to the best stuff yet. The great stuff is that means that our count for 2017 is going to be 5 churches that we've been able to be a part of. And next year, we're going to hit 11, which is just really, really exciting to me to be able to double that. So that's the part I want you to clap at. That's really, really cool. One of the things we do, in addition to just supporting specific individual plants and planters, is provide leadership for the Exponential Network. They produce e-books and podcasts and stuff on leadership and church planting and disciple making and stuff like that. They also run the largest gathering of church planters in the world. We'll have about 10,000 people be a part of an Exponential conference this year, and about 500 or 600 of them are going to be here at the End Zone in September. September 11th and 12th, we're going to be hosting our second, for the second time, we're going to be hosting the DC Regional Exponential right here, and I would love for you all to be a part. There are 2 ways that you can be a part. One, there are probably people here today who've been feeling God nudging them towards professional ministry, maybe nudging them towards church planting. I see Matt Blank out there. It wasn't that long ago that he was right where you were. So if that thought has crossed your mind, I'm not looking for a commitment. I'm not asking you to quit your job yet. I'm just asking you to take 2 days off work and come listen to Exponential and see what God might say. Even if you're not thinking that, let me just encourage you. I know it sounds weird to take time off work to come to a church planting conference, but it's so encouraging. I promise you, you will be encouraged if you come and listen to see what God has to say through that conference. The second reason I'd love for you to come is we need volunteers. We need a couple dozen volunteers to help pull this thing off. There's going to be a lot of stuff going on. So some of you, Victor Tyrandola, I don't know if he's here right now, he is the coffee king of Exponential, and he kept all these church planters caffeinated up for the 2 days. It was great. So if you are interested in volunteering, please see us after the service. I'll tell you how to connect in just a minute, but you can always go to Dale Spaulding. He's in the back there. Then the next big announcement I want to just mentioned this morning, Starlight. Thank you. I almost forgot it for a second. We've been talking about Starlight Cinema for the last couple weeks. It's coming up starting, I guess not next weekend, but the following weekend. Starlight is a great opportunity for us to serve our community. One of my favorite stories from Starlight Cinema is when a New Lifer was at the grocery store and overheard two women talking behind her, and the one woman said, "Hey, what are you doing tonight? Are you doing something fun with the family?" She said, "Yeah, we're going to the New Life movie night. It's going to be great. You should come too." And it's not a New Life thing, really. It's actually the county puts on Starlight Cinema, but we kind of just take it over. We just show up with our T-shirts. I mean, they let us and everything. It's not like we do it sneakily. But we show up and provide the family fun. We take our moon bounces, a bunch of games, Legos, all kinds of fun stuff just to help the kids have a great time before the movie starts. I would love for you guys to be part of that. It's an easy way to serve. It's an easy way to do something for our community and just to give back a little bit and show them God's love. So if you're interested in either of those two things, either helping out at Exponential or helping out at Starlight Cinema, you have a couple options for next steps. One is you can just see someone on staff and we'll try to direct you in the right direction. Two, in the lobby at the table as you leave today, there's a sign-up sheet in a clipboard, and you can just put your name and info there. We'll get in touch with you. Or you can use the app. If you just swipe over to the second page, there's a volunteer button. Click that volunteer button, and we'll reach out and let you know how to do that. Okay, great. That's all I've got. I'm going to go ahead and stand up. I will update you as you do that. The Kentucky mission trip is back. They had a great trip. No injuries. Yay. Lots of conversation. Some people accepted Christ. It was a wonderful, wonderful trip. And then this Friday, our Ecuador trip departs. And in fact, I have two children who could be sponsored, and we could take a gift to your child if you'd like. Anyway, we're going to be visiting the church we helped start there and serving the kids, and I'd ask you to be praying for all of us that are going to be on the trip. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for what you did this past week in Kentucky, and we're so excited that people came to know you, that conversations happened, that are going to live into eternity. God, thank you so much for keeping everyone safe and blessing that trip. God, we pray that you would do that again this coming week, that as the team leaves for Ecuador, that you would give us safe travels, that you would help us to love the children of Pueblo Nuevo as you do, and that you would guide us every step of the way to be your hands and feet to that community. God, thank you for everyone here and for how you bless each and every one of us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Have a great week.